Party Chairman, SecGen, members of the CEC, comrades and fellow activists, a very good morning. I wish to start by bringing everyone's attention to a picture that I think all of us will have drawn at some point in our childhood. On a sheet of paper, imagine drawing green grass, a blue sky, and a smiling sun in the sky, and somewhere on the green grassy slope, a little cottage with maybe a door, two windows, maybe four windows, and almost always a chimney. And usually next to this house, there will be a tree, and I think most children will do this, they will add in red apples. And this, the child will say proudly, is my home. I've drawn this picture too. My daughter today is also drawing this picture. But if you look at this with a child's eye, which I did, and you look all around you, you'll find that actually our home is not quite like that. Our tropical climate can't ever grow apples, and we live in a very compact and dense urban landscape. And most certainly, we have no use for chimneys whatsoever. But I think this, for maybe many of us, is the first inkling that there is home as we see it and experience it. And then there is home as books and stories and movies tell us. I think the two are different. Another experience that I wish to share with you also occurred early in my life. I was quite poor in English, so my parents, feeling a little bit anxious about that, had friends send me activity books from overseas in a bid to improve my English. And the activity book starts by asking a series of questions, and then there's a little blank that you're supposed to fill in. So it starts off by asking you, which country do you live in? So that's quite simple. The answer is Singapore. And then the next question, what is the capital of your country? And you're supposed to still fill in a blank. So, well, it's Singapore, so we fill that in again. Next question, which state do you live in? Okay, it's a little bit harder to answer, but, you know, in the spirit of perseverance and believing that you must have an answer, again, we wrote down Singapore. Which is the nearest city to where you live, okay? We can think of a few new towns, but, you know, my parents said that those are new towns, they're not actually a city. So city, again, has to be Singapore. The next questions were, which town does your father work in? Which town does your mother work in? And so on and so forth. So after a while, we kind of gave up. But we were aware that maybe if we lived in what is called a normal country, then maybe the answers are not supposed to be the same word all the time. Well, these are childhood stories, but over time, I have come to learn that my country and home is unique and the reasons why this is so. We are a port, an island, a city, and a state. My home, my city, and my country are all one and the same. We are like no other country, and we follow our own path. Please allow me to continue my address in Mandarin. 我今天想来跟大家谈的是家对我的意义。首先，让我先跟大家说一些有的没有的。这不是我们方言中所说的五味博哎，我是真的想谈，是哪一些东西是其他国家所有的，哪些国哪些东西呢？是我们反而没有的。 的确有很多别的国家所有的，我们新加坡没有。我们没有四季分明的气候，我们没有几百年甚至是上千年的积累的财富和文化，我们没有所谓的山川河流，也没有天然资源。可是很多其他国家没有的，我们却有。我们有廉洁的政府，和谐的社会，快速的发展，还有安全的邻里。 我们大厦林立，我们居者有其屋。我们这个国家一滴石油也产不出，可是我们却成为了全世界最重要的石化中心之一。我们是一个国土面积非常小的小岛，我们完全没有所谓的国内航空市场，可是我们却可以培养出全球第一的航空公司。在我们的市场里，可以买到来自全球各地的商品和食品。 可以这么说，我们是一个几乎什么都没有，但是却什么都尽力为人民提供的国家。 这并不是理所当然的，对我来说，这是一个不折不扣的奇迹。我们的国家确确实实是独特的，所以我们发展的道路是我们一步一步探索出来的。几十年前，我相信没有任何专家或者学者可以告诉我们要怎么样脱离贫困。 要怎么样的在沼泽地上面建立起工业园区？没有任何一个国家可以告诉我们，在一个动荡不安的一个时代、动荡不安的一个地区，怎么样安居乐业，怎么样保家卫国？既然我们的国家是独特的，那我们就要走自己的路。我认为我们没有必要去模仿别的政府或者别的国家。大家想一想，其他地大物博的国家。 他们有石油，有矿产，他们的经济再怎么衰退，他们的国家企业再怎么低效率，他们面临怎么样的问题？最终，他们的国家还是可以养得起。有农耕基础的国家，人民有的时候觉得生活在城市里面压力太大了，他们还可以回家种田。这些条件我们没有。那么一些国家，他们可以拥有非常昂贵的福利制度。 他们甚至可以创造连年的赤字，债台高筑。今年是兔年，有一些国家呢是寅时卯粮，这个意思就是把虎年的时候呢，就把兔年的粮食给吃完了，今天吃明天的，今年吃明年的，那么这一代消费的需要下一代来偿还。其他的国家他们也许可以这么做，但是。 我认为我们必须要对自己的前途负责任。五年一次的大选，我们总是会听到许许多多不同的声音，这一点都没有错。民主社会本来就应该如此，有批评才有进步，有回馈才有改善。问题是我们应该怎么进步，怎么改善呢？我们是越做越好，还是像老舍所说的越改越良？ 大家请注意，这不是善良的良，而是凄凉的良。我在听到这些不同的声音的时候，有一些论点确实是令我感到担忧。如果有一天，我们的政坛真的出现了新的执政者，他们不了解我们国家强盛根本，随意更改政策，断送了国家赖以生存的经济途径。 我想，我们的下一代不是一个吃得更少的问题，而是可能连基本生活都会有麻烦。昨天我在《联合早报》上面看到了一篇文章，感触很深。作者他在叙述自己的太太在送女儿到外国念书的时候，一直千吩咐万吩咐，女儿切记不可像在新加坡一样半夜回家或太早出门。 切记不可像在新加坡一样把钱包拿在手里闲逛，不可以在新加坡这样那样。然后呢，作者恍然大悟，原来这些在新加坡的理所当然，正是我们所拥有的最宝贵的财富。我看了这篇文章之后，我的感触很深，因为我想这些叮咛的话，可能在我们全国有许许多多的父母都在这样子的跟他们的孩子说。 毕竟新加坡呢，处在一个环球化的一个世界，我们的国人时常都会出国去学习、生活，或者是工作。我想有一天，我自己的孩子也会长大，我可能也要送他们出远门。到时我会这样子的叮嘱他们吗？我会告诉他们，你们一定要当心，因为别的国家不像在新加坡这样子。还是我会告诉他们说，孩子。 你去的国家会比我们这里好得多，你去了以后就不要回来。我不希望新加坡成为这样子的一个地方，我不希望有一天我要这样子同我的孩子说话。我希望我的孩子跟我一样，不管世界多么具吸引力，不管我们飞得多高多远，他还是会认同这是我们最温馨的家园。家对我来说是独特的。 家是我们在纷乱世界中唯一的避风港，家是我们要留给孩子们的地方。所以，同志们、同胞们，让我们团结一致，齐心齐力，一起来经营这个家，鞠躬尽瘁。谢谢大家。
Thank you, Comrade Anne.